Santa Rosa, there once lived a couple named Hugo and Imelda. Every mealtime, they quarreled over the chore of washing the dishes. Imelda would scold Hugo if he refused to wash the dishes. Sometimes, she would become angry and call him names, and if he talked back, she would get the coconut meat brew and chase him with it. He would run to the house of his compadre and hide there till his wife's anger had passed. The neighbors familiarly called Cross Imelda Camelda and Hugo Capugong. One day, just as they were finishing their lunch, Capugong announced,
"I will not wash the dishes anymore."
"And who says so?"
"I say so. I worked hard in the fields this morning. I will not wash any dish."
"And who, Mr. Hugo, is going to wash these dishes?"
You! You are the woman! You should do all the housework!
"And what do? You tie the carabaos to the reeds of the field, and then you lie down on the grass to watch it graze? You call that hard work?" "I cook, clean the house, scrub the floor, wash your clothes. I do all the works that only slaves should do. And yet you refuse to help me out washing these things from which you have eaten?"
Kamaldang's voice was now raised to a high pitch, and her tears poised on her eyelids ready to pour down. She looked at Kaugong at her broom. She grabbed the broom. She raised the broom to strike him.
Have you to say?
Let's stop quarreling over the plates. Let's have a waiter. The first one who will speak after I have said begin will wash the dishes. Always.
Only that? The first one who talks will always wash the plates, the pans, the pots, the pans. Always.
Right. Even if you just say one word to me or to anything or to anybody, you will wash the dishes. Always.
That's easy. I can keep my mouth shut even for a week. You can't. You even talk to your carabao.
All right. Are you ready?
Kamaldang sat in front of him across the table. She nodded her head and pressed her lips.
Okay. Begin.
They both fell silent. They sat at the table looking at each other across the unwashed plates and bowls and spoons. They did not like to leave each other for fear that one would talk himself without the other one hearing. They sat there just staring. Soon, the cat began to mew for food. Neither Kamaldang nor Kaugong paid any attention to its mewing. The cat jumped upon the drying dishes to lick the leftovers. Kamaldang did not drive it away, neither did Kaugong.
Soon, it was getting late in the afternoon, but they went on sitting mutely at the lunch table. Their eyes were tired from staring hard from each other. Tears began to roll down their cheeks. Kaugong's shirt became damp with his sweat. Kamaldang's sweat gathered on her forehead and trickled down to the sides of their face. It fell drop by drop to her breast.
Compadre Ugong! Oh, compadre!
Kaugong didn't answer, and the neighbor called again.
Comadre Maldang! Yo!
Comadre Malda! You! Compadre Ugong! Where are your ox?
Kamaldang didn't answer. Ka Ugong looked at her silently.
Perhaps nobody's at home. But why did they leave the ladder at the door? They usually remove the ladder. Well, I just go up and get the axe and return it later.
When the neighbor went up the bamboo ladder, he was surprised to see Kamaldang and Ka Ugong sitting silently at the table, where the plates had dried up with leftovers. He hurried towards them.
Compadre Ugong, what happened?
Ka Ugong neither moved or talked. The neighbor repeated his question. He shook Ka Ugong's shoulder. Ka Ugong let him shake him, closing his lips tighter.
Compadre Ugong, what happened? What happened?
Speak, comadre. What happened?
He shook her shoulders too. She pushed him roughly aside, but didn't speak.
Did you eat something poisonous? A food that made you dumb?
He shook each one alternately, but still, neither stood up nor thought. The neighbor was alarmed. He didn't get the axe when one out to the rest of the neighbors. She told him that something terrible happened to his compadre Ugo and Comadre Malda. The neighbors gathered at Kamaldang's dining room. They took turns trying to make them speak, but the two continued to sit staring at each other in silence. Kamaldang looked at her husband threateningly for a moment and closed her eyes. Ka Ugong knew that she did so to avoid looking at the neighbors. He also closed his eyes and ignored everyone who had come up to his house. Kamaldang was very angry with her compadre's interference, but she dared not to speak her mind. She pretended to be asleep.
The neighbor was very much worried. She ran to the village herdman. The herdman came, and when he saw the motionless, silent husband and wife sitting at the table, he declared that they were bewitched. He spread a wooden burry mat in the center of the sala and asked the bewitched couple to lie down. Ka Ugong obediently lay down and closed his eyes. He curled up and went to sleep, but Kamaldang refused to get up from where she sat at the dining table.
Ah! The spirit must take possession of her. Must very stubborn. I must break its spell.
He then produced a small bag he always carried, 9 pieces of betel leaf and a piece of areca nut and a little lime from a tiny bottle. He examined the leaves closely to choose those which had veins running in an identical arrangement on each side of the mid rib. He cut the nut into 9 pieces. He spread a little lime on each betel leaf, rolled them and wrapped them around each piece and of the areca nut. He now had 9 rings of the leaves.
This represents the lost soul of the couple.
He chewed the leaf and nut. When he had chewed it, he spat on his palm, dipped a forefinger of the other hand into the nut-colored saliva and marked it with a cross on the foreheads of Ka Ugong and Kamaldang. Ka Ugong did not seem to feel the old man's finger on his forehead. Kamaldang caught the man's finger and twisted it. He moved toward Ka Ugong, who was lying down, calling his name softly and slowly several times.
Nakita nga pagpagayong alaong nito'y rumarkakin niya na! Kam Ugong! Come back, Ugong!
Kaugong did not move or speak.
Si Kamo dito'y nga babae, hanggang nga natin ta, umikat ka dito'y kinyana. Umikat ka kinyana, lagi dito'y nga babae, yoy di alubong. Hanggang nga natin ta, kita ang jayupan. Nagalat ka nga uging, na hinahinang mo. May kan kamaldang, come back to your body now. Kamaldang!
Kamaldang did not answer. Evening fell the frightened village, the frightened because the herb doctor said that the spell might be cast on some other villagers besides Kaugong and Kamaldang. He called to bewitch couple slowly at first and then louder, but still they did not move. Kamaldang soon became tired, so she reclined against the bamboo wall.
This is the first witchery of its kind I have met here. By their silence, I believe that they are dead. Their spirit is driven away by the witch have left their bodies. The only thing, in order to keep their souls in peace and to prevent this witchcraft from spreading among us, is to bury them.
The woman began to weep for Kamaldang. She had leaned rigidly against the back of her chair, closed her eyes and shut her lips tight. The herdman asked the men gathered around to lift the couple into their coffins.
We will bury them at sunrise. Some of us have to stay and keep away from the dead.
The man easily lifted Kaugong and placed him inside his coffin. Surely, he said to himself, he would win the wager. He would not be afraid of being buried. Why? He would just get out of the grave when the neighbors are gone. He thought everything going on was great fun and he was enjoying himself. How he would be frightened them all when he returned from his grave. The herdman approached Kamaldang. Although her eyes were closed, she had been listening to his directions. She was afraid that he would surely force her into the coffin if she did not tell him to go away. But she did not hear Kaugong speak. She opened her eyes just as the herdman, aided by the other men, put his arms around her to lift her up from the chair.
Don't touch me! Shame on you for coming here and meddling with our lives! Get out! Get out of our house! You talk first!
Did you guys see that? She will always wash the dishes! Always!
Kamaldang lifted up the lid of Kaugong's coffin to strike his head with it, but he ran out with his neighbors, still shouting happily and saying,
I won! I know I won! I will never wash the dishes!